Alright! That was actually a much better episode than I thought it was going to be, because I bet everybody was thinking that it would be pretty much the same as last episode and that Shirin was going to go, but turns out what we got was even better. It gave me what I was wishing for last episode, a lot more from a certain characters, a better read on some people, and just... yeah, I'm really looking forward to seeing what's going to be happening in this season. This was a much-needed episode, even though every episode has been pretty good so far this season. This is take two, if you're wondering. So, Shirin starts going off on how everyone voted out her best friend. We've seen this before, and honestly, I think part of her comments are just really not needed, because like she's complaining that she wasn't part of like the young, pretty skinny group, you know, growing up. But Shirin, that's not really abnormal, okay? It's part of life. And if you're going to just complain that you weren't part of the popular group, that's not really doing anything to justify you. You should just feel like, stay that you're not accepted really by anybody, because like I wasn't part of the popular group of people in like high school, even though I did get fairly well known or noticed in a good amount of my high school classes, but I never really took advantage of it. I just went with the flow and tried to divert away some attention, okay? I'm not trying to say that like I was a very popular kid or somebody that made friends with a lot of people, because it was actually the opposite. I was just fairly well known and I didn't have that many friends in high school, but you know, I'm just saying, she's kind of barking up a tree that shouldn't be barked at in this situation. Just focus on the game, Shirin. Right. And then on the blue tribe, well, it turns out it truly was Rodney simply just going over to Joaquin and becoming all buddy-buddy with him. Just, come on, man on the blue collar, let me get a read on you, okay? Because it's just getting a little ridiculous, because I listened to Rob Cesternino's interview with phone interview with Lindsay. I completely forgot to do it last time, and turns out I was right in that the women on the blue collar tribe were together, but Mike got into Kelly's head and was able to convince her to come over and support him. Although why Dan became buddy-buddy with Rodney last episode, I still have no idea on that. It seems like it was purely just to go against Lindsay, but just, yeah. It's tough to get a read on these guys, let me tell you, even though I am more interested in those guys than a couple of the other guys in this cast. I'll try and bring up more of that later when I feel like it is appropriate. So on that reward challenge, Jeff at the start of it is commenting, oh yeah, as Kameka is just like running up that obstacle, but I was thinking, Jeff, the bulk of this challenge is actually to just hit targets with the slingshot, you know? So being more physically adept at getting up a structure doesn't matter. All that matters is that you're a good shot with the slingshot. So it didn't matter that the two tribes were unmatched in terms of athleticism. It was just that Nagarote was able to hit the targets before Eskameka did. But I have to point out one thing that seems a little bit odd, in that I think the rules of the challenge were kinda not clear to me, because you noticed how everybody, after they hit a target, always switched to a different person. That seemed to imply that everybody was responsible for hitting one target, okay? Now, I can't recall any other challenges where they've done this. That's something that Top Shot, I think, is more known to do. But that's just what it seemed like to me. So I don't totally get what the deal was with Jen going back up to the platform at the end of the challenge and hitting the last target for her tribe, whereas the blue tribe always rotated the member, and that Tyler was never able to hit his. Just, I don't know. I think one could really argue that there might have been a bit of a rules breach there. Now, I'm not picky that the Red Tribe won, because they absolutely deserve that win, but it just seemed to me that that's what needed to happen. Everybody was responsible for hitting their own target. Now, I can't remember really any other challenge in the history of survival where they did this, but just, something I would have liked to have known. But based on a couple of things that occurred in this episode and last episode that I can't really describe, I'm seriously beginning to give a lot more attention to Jen now because, well, a lot of people have been hyping Joe to get, like, a winner's edit, but he just hasn't really been doing that much. Heck, the most that we got out of him was Joe versus Vince, and then him telling Nina to just one back in that challenge. Just, I'm not feeling this guy anymore. Just, I'm not really seeing him do anything, you know? So I'm thinking that these people are kind of just not really got much of a case to vouch for here. Now, it is possible, absolutely, that he could, you know, re-emerge as a bigger player later in the game, because Natalie did that last season. Tony started doing that come the merge. Arguably Tyson started to do this. Brett emerged as a threat later in the game. Arguably Danny emerged as a threat later in the game, you know? Just, it can happen, but Okay. Oh, forgot about Sophie. Silly me. Yeah. Can't forget her. But I'm kind of feeling the same way about Tyler, because, like, I think there were a few people who were stating that he, you know, was probably going to get the farthest out of all the white collars, and while that seems like a very darn good possibility given the other two, again, just we haven't gotten that much from him, and yeah, he was barely even mentioned in this episode. Like, the reason he ended up sticking with Joaquin and Rodney at the end, just, yeah, It's tough, because I've been getting such a good read on these guys that, you know, I just don't want to see anybody neglected and not given much camera time, because if you remember my Kagayan videos, I was complaining the same thing about Jeremiah, Wu, and I think Jeffra. Yeah. Okay. And this is another reward that Survivor has done that I'm looking at. I'm just like, I don't get any thrill from this. I mean, like, it's unique, absolutely, but just, what's up? I never used to complain about this when I was watching old school and new school hours of the show, but now I'm complaining about rewards all the time now. What's up? And then we get the infamous bit of Mike and Rodney debating about whether or not they're going to throw the challenge to get rid of Joe at first. And at first I was kind of annoyed that they were going to do that, because obviously it's never really worked out in the history of the show, as everyone kept mentioning, especially Rodney and Joaquin. But when Mike started throwing the bits of, I want to do this to take care of Kelly, I looked at the situation and I go, wait a sec, I think that these guys are actually planning ahead for once. They're not just making a rash decision, because almost all the other times in the history of the show where they're trying to throw a challenge, Kay, it's always been, let's throw this one challenge to get rid of this one guy, or chick, and then let's carry everything from there on out. That's always what it's been. This time it's, let's throw this one challenge, get rid of this one guy in order to make our situation better and figure out our positions. It just felt different, so I gotta admit, for once, I was actually kind of rooting for them to be able to throw it, even though there was a part of me that still didn't totally want them to do it. Because I didn't think that Sierra would really benefit, but I'll get back to her later. And that immunity challenge, a couple of things to point out here. Number one, it seemed like a couple of the people that might have known that the challenge was going to be thrown, Dan mainly, actually were trying to do good in the challenge. Now, if you're blown out 3-0, it does look a little stupid, but if you're trying to throw a challenge, just, why don't you just throw it? Yeah. I really would like to know exactly who knew that the challenge was going to be thrown and who didn't, even though I think by the time they went to Tribal, everybody knew the challenge was going to be thrown. They just didn't really mention it to Jeff. But it was hilarious how Mike was trying to give it to Kelly, but it just almost didn't work. And how did nobody hear them? Now, I know that there are several things that were protecting Mike and Kelly, because they're 10 feet away from everybody, the wind is going right in their mouths, so the words are being swallowed almost, so nobody can hear them except each other. And Mike, I think, can whisper pretty good with that voice of his, although for some reason it seemed to change this episode. Just, how did nobody hear that? And didn't see Kelly going, Right. But it didn't bother me that much that the Red Tribe got immunity, because I did want to see what was going to happen on the Blue Tribe. And then, turns out, it does indeed go to Sierra being the swing vote, as last episode hinted at, but Rodney and Joe have apparently switched places, and just... it's another indication that goes to show that the guys on the blue collar are just not... fully making the thought process known. Although I will give Dan a little more pro for trying to make up to Sierra, but it wasn't just him, because Mike was there and he was also able to help Dan out. I don't entirely believe Dan still, but I got the feeling that he was trying a lot more this time, so I'll give him that. And Sierra did state repeatedly that Mike did try and make amends with her, so I get the idea that they at least have made up. Dan, as usual, is in the hot seat again. And given how these blocks had kind of shifted, so it wasn't directly blue collar versus non-blue collars, it did give Sierra a little bit more reason, I think, to think about her position. But I still hold by to what I said in the last video, that either way, she wouldn't be in that great of a position long term, because if she sticks with Dan and Mike, everybody will know that she voted out Joaquin. And even though everybody, like with Tony voting out Clift, will be blamed except her, they'll still know that she did that, and even though she was stating, you know, like, I felt more welcome by the other side, and yet I'm still gonna stick it to you, just, it doesn't really provide any benefits in my mind. But if she goes over to Joaquin, Tyler, and Rodney, then that's like Penner in Cook Islands, where everybody will perceive you as not being loyal to anybody and only looking after your own skin, even though, let's be realistic, I too had one heck of a loaded die hand. Huh? Right. But even though I do feel I'm justified by saying long-term, it doesn't really work for Sierra. Short-term, I came to the conclusion that it would actually be better for her to vote out Joaquin. Why? Because Rodney would flip off the handle, and I think they're estimating correctly that the merge was about to happen, so everybody will be looking at Rodney going, what the heck, you know? So, I began to think that it would honestly be better for her the next day, at least, to vote out Joaquin, even though the edit did indicate that she would probably vote out Joe. But I wasn't really too picky who would go, because I thought it would be a good blindside or fallout either way, to be honest. But at Tribal, I began to think that she was going to vote out Joaquin, because you notice when she's going up the walk to the voting area, and then she starts writing the J and the O, she starts writing it pretty far to the left. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean anything, because people have not always put the name of the person they're voting out in the center, far from it, because you remember when Colby was writing Sandra's name the day he got voted out of HVV? He wrote her name super small in the upper left, I think. You know? But it just seemed to indicate that if you're going to write the start of a name far over to the left, you're writing out a longer name. And I ended up being right. Joaquin ended up getting blindsided. And the fallout from Rodney is going to be epic. So, do I think Sierra made the right decision? Long term, shrug. Short term, yes. But I will admit the alliance of Mike, Dan, Sierra, Joe question mark, and Kelly question mark is relying on a lot of ifs here because they're assuming that Joe isn't going to go back to the girls. They're assuming that Rodney isn't going to go over to the other tribe. They're assuming that Kelly is going to come back. They're assuming Sierra isn't going to go. They have a lot of ifs that they need to play with here. They have to really see what the merge is going to do in terms of where everyone is going to stand, huh? So there's no clear cut victory for this group. They've got to hope that things really turn out for the better if they stick together, which they might not, okay? Even though everyone's predicting an epic battle, it seems, between Blue and No Collar. And if you haven't seen Rob and Steven's know-it-all video, I highly recommend that you see it. They throw a lot of good theories for this season and what's going to happen in the merge, okay? Whew. All right, so that pretty much finishes up this episode, I think. I'm really looking forward to the merge. Here, there's a lot of people that I want to watch out for, see what they're going to do. Oh, and I forgot to mention if Tyler goes back to Carolyn, because I'm pretty sure he knows that she has the idol. At least he seemed to drop that in episode 4, yeah. So, a lot of stuff to watch out for here, people. Holy crap, this one's been a long one. Not bad. See you guys.